Good morning. It's good to have you here. Today is a great day because we can gather together to worship. And so we've been going through this What About series. It's been interesting how that has impacted different people in different ways. And I guess because all of us are in a different place in our life. And, you know, sometimes I think people, they want to be with God. They want to have that relationship with Him. But sometimes there's just something keeping that next step, something that just seems to be blocking the way. And sometimes it's the things that we're dealing with, so questions we're dealing with. So hopefully through all this, God is touching us, teaching us, helping us to understand that there are things we won't understand in life. And today is one of those topics. It's one of those that really I just wrestled with a lot this week, just how to approach it. And because it's about something that we all understand, have heard about, or have been a part of, and that's tragedy in our lives. It's a very subjective thing. It's something that each person deals with in a different way. And you know, there's a lot of different kinds of tragedies. There's natural disasters, storms that bring a lot of destruction. There's people who have financial struggles in their life. There's the unexpected death of a loved one, either through disease or violence or, you know, just unexpected consequences. There's broken relationships. There's abandonment. There's divorce. There's abuse. There's just a lot of things. And the list could go on, and you could probably fill in a few of your own. And I just up front, I'm not going to be able to deal with all of those things, all right? And all of those things in a very specific way, because most of the times when you hear something like this, you interpret it through the one specific incident or thing that you have in your life. But I want to share what I would call some principles of God's Word that helps us apply these things in different ways in our lives. Today may bring pain, it may bring relief. It may answer questions. It may bring up more questions. It may bring tears of joy or tears of sorrow. And no matter where you're at, I just ask that we all approach it with this prayer. Lord, touch me where I need to be touched. Heal me where I need to be healed. And forgive me where I need to be forgiven. I think it's just a good prayer to enter every worship time, because I pray each week, Lord, you know the needs here today far greater than I. Just touch people where they need to be touched. And as we approach this today, and as wherever you're at in your life, just to open your life to God's leading and God's teaching and God's Word. We're going to be sharing a video at the end that's actually going to be a little bit longer than what I'm going to share, because the impact, I think, of that message, God will use that to touch your heart also. So I'm going to very quickly share some things. Start off with this question: why does tragedy happen in this world? Well, let me give you a big picture answer. We live in a broken world, and that has been around ever since Adam and Eve sinned in the Garden of Eden. God created the world. He created things in perfect harmony. It says that He walked with Adam and Eve in the garden, and it was all fine until Adam and Eve sinned, and that brought a separation and a destruction to God's perfect creation. Genesis 3:17 through 19 says this. This is God speaking to Adam. He says, because you listened to your wife and ate from the tree about which I commanded you, you must not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. Through painful toil you will eat all the days of your life. It will produce thorns and thistles for you, and you will eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your brow you will eat your food until you have returned to the ground, since from it you were taken. For dust you are, and to dust you'll return. So from the very beginning of time in the Garden of Eden, God's perfect creation was corrupted. It was upset, it was destroyed, however you want to say it, by the act of disobedience. And tragedy enters into God's story and man's story very early on, because the sons of Adam and Eve, Cain and Abel, came to a dispute, and because of jealousy, Cain kills Abel, the first murder in the Bible. And it was all about the heart of men and jealousy and all those things that go on. An interesting passage in Romans 8, Robert read from it earlier, but in the beginning of that chapter it says, even creation groans, longing to be set free from the bondage of the sin that had happened in the Garden of Eden. So it has impacted creation, it's impacted mankind for many, many years. And that doesn't necessarily soothe us, but I think that's the bottom line. We need to grasp that. Why is not everything perfect? Why is not everything good? Why don't we just have a rose garden all the time to live in? Because we live in a broken and fallen world. And that's what redemption is about. And that's what gives us the hope of eternal life. That's what gives us the glorious message of redemption and forgiveness through the blood of Jesus Christ, so that we leave all of this behind so that we can dwell with Him forever in eternity. But meanwhile, we live in a broken and fallen world. A second thing we need to realize in that context is this, that it is Satan's goal to destroy and disrupt the order of God's creation and the lives of those who follow Him. Nothing gives him better pleasure than to see a life destroyed because of bad decisions that were made, or something happened, or attitudes that crept into someone's life. Jesus said in John chapter 10:10, speaking of Satan, He says, "For he comes to kill, steal, and destroy." And that's the impact that Satan has on this world. And he steals and he kills and destroys when he leads someone to bring harm to someone else. He still kills and destroys when he leads someone to bring harm to themselves. And sometimes those are because of decisions they've made, and decisions have consequences, and bad things happen sometimes as a result of the things that we have decided along the way. A third big picture answer is simply this. There are things that will happen that we'll never understand this side of heaven. I'm not going to stand up here and tell you I got it all figured out, because I don't have it all figured out. And there's been times I've dealt with people and their families and situations that to me it didn't seem fair, it didn't seem right, and I could give no explanation on this side of heaven what it was all about. But the Word of God says, trust in me. And sometimes God sees, not sometimes, all the time, God sees from an eternal perspective where we only see from an earthly perspective. James Dobson, a Christian counselor and a head of Focus on the Family Ministries for many years, addresses this, and I really like what he has to say. Here's what he says. My strongest advice is that each of us acknowledge before a crisis occurs, that's the key, before a crisis occurs, if possible, that our trust in Him must be independent of our understanding. There's nothing wrong with trying to understand, but we must not lean on our ability to comprehend. Think about that. We must not say, I'm only going to accept God if I can understand what's going on. If it's beyond me, then I'm not going to accept it. Throughout the Bible, we see God's people suffer. You have the story of Job in the Old Testament, who suffered a lot. You see Jeremiah the prophet, a great spokesman for God, suffered a lot. The Apostle Paul in the New Testament, he spent some time in his letter to the Corinthians telling about all the beatings and floggings and imprisonments and all the things that he went through for the sake of the gospel. He was not spared from that pain. He was not spared from agony and anguish and tragedy. It's throughout Scripture. But we know that God does not turn His back on those, even though we may not understand them all. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, the chapter on love, but it ends with this. Paul says, "Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror, then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall be fully known, even as I am fully known." Paul says, I don't have it all figured out. I don't know the why of all of this. And one day, it's all going to become clear. But until that day, He's going to remain faithful. He's going to remain faithful. So why does tragedy happen in this world? We live in a broken, fallen world. Satan is still doing his best to mess things up. And there's going to be times that we can't comprehend in our mind why things happen the way they did. But what do you do when that happens? Let me just share this. Don't turn to drugs and alcohol to try to dull the pain. Why do I even bring that up? Well, because I see it happen so many times. Some people say, well, the Bible doesn't ever address, you know, drinking. That's not true. Look at Proverbs 20, verse 1. Wine is a mocker and beer a brawler. Whoever is led astray by them is not wise. And I just share my personal take on this. My personal feeling is, you know, people say, well, it's okay to do social drinking, you know, here and there, blah, blah, blah. You know, why open yourself to that? Because I'll tell you, there's people that's done that and something happens. And what do they turn to? They turn to that and then it destroys their lives. I've seen so many lives just destroyed by these two things right here. And so I'm not going to be very sympathetic if you try to convince me otherwise, because I've seen too many lives impacted by it. But so many times people just turn to it to try to dull the pain, to forget it, and things like that. And the bad thing is it only makes things worse. That's why I bring that, just the life experience I've seen in people's lives. Well, what do you do when your world's upside down and you don't understand? And you don't. Well, I just say turn to the things you know. There's a lot of things I don't know. But sometimes there's some things that are solid promises. John 3:16, for God so loved the world, that's you and me, that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That's solid. And when the days are dark and when it's all crazy and it doesn't make any sense and the tears are coming and the heartache is there, that pain is real. But so is the love of God still to be with us in those tough times. And I know that's easier said than done, but you still need to turn to the things you know. John chapter 14, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he says, hey guys, I'm leaving you. And they say, well, where are you going? Well, then Jesus says, look, I'm going to prepare a place for you. If it weren't so, I wouldn't have told you. I'm going to go and prepare a place. And if I go, I shall return so that one day, what? I can take you there to be with me also. That's a promise. It's a promise of God. And when things don't make sense, you can still depend on the promises of God. Psalm 23, you've heard that before, usually at funeral services, right? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, which declares there that he will be the provider, he will sustain us. I shall not want is meaning I shall not have any wants, because he will be there. He's my shepherd, he's taking care of everything. Then down in verse 6 and says, verse 4, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. They prepare us a table, where? In the presence of my enemies and all those things that surround me, all those things I'm scared of, all those things I don't like. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. And then verse 6, and surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Turn to the things you know when tragedy occurs, because sometimes it's those things that are there to get you through. One final thing, hang on to the hope. Hang on to the hope. Romans 5 says, and we rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, we also rejoice in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God has poured out his love into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, whom he has given us. Biblical hope is not an empty hope, it's a life-giving hope. Hang on to hope. And one final thing, accept the comfort of God and the comfort of others. 2 Corinthians 1, Paul says this, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in our troubles so that we can comfort those in any troubles with the comfort we ourselves have received from them. That passage, the key word there is comfort. And it talks about two types of comfort. Well, first, the word comfort is a word that means to call alongside. It paints a picture of someone coming alongside and putting their arm around you, coming up alongside and saying, I am here, it's going to be okay. And that's the word that's used. Our God is a God of what? Of all comforts, who comforts us in our time of sorrows. But that second half is so important also, because it also says, so that, purpose clause, so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received. You see, the body of Christ is not a bunch of individuals. The body of Christ is a living, breathing organism. And it says there that we are to be there for each other. There are people here that have gone through some things that maybe you've never gone through, but maybe you will sometime. They can share that comfort. If you're one of those people that have gone through something, then use that as an ability to share and encourage someone else who's just going through that for the very first time. Paul says it's such a beautiful thing. Depend on the comfort of God, and then depend on the comfort of others. I'm going to go into this video. I think you'll be touched by it. It's from Milton, who attends this service. He and his wife, Marie. And just let God speak to you through what he has to say.
Milton Torres, and I guess in a nutshell, we're going to speak about tragedy and how you deal with it. I have my son Milton Jr. that was murdered back in May of 2011, a couple of weeks before his 25th birthday. My son felt that he needed to rededicate his life a week before that happened. And I'm very grateful to God that that happened. He came to me with tears in his eyes after a little Bible study that we had. And he was like, "Dad, I felt the need to rededicate my life to Jesus." And I was like, "Great." It was wonderful news at the moment. And then following Friday, I get a phone call at 2 o'clock in the morning that he was taken to the hospital. He was injured pretty badly, but that was it. That was the only news they gave me over the phone. And so when I got to the hospital, his fiance and his friends were all there, and you know the look on their faces wasn't good. So it got kind of weary real quick for me. And so I had a doctor come and introduce himself. He said, "Just give us a moment, and we'll bring you in to see your son." So here I'm thinking that he was okay, or he was going to be okay. So that's when a police officer walked up to me and introduced himself, and came. Then the doctor came, and they asked me to come into this room. So I said, "No, I'm not going in that room, because I know what that means, stepping into that room, and I didn't want to accept that." And then the doctor comes to me and he says, "Please, we need you to identify the body, because he has no wallet on him. My son always left his wallet in his car." So I said, "But who are you speaking about?" And he said, "Well, that's what we want you to come and see, if this is your son." So I walked to the back, and my second oldest son walked with me. He was there. And so as we're coming in, and we're walking by a whole bunch of patients, and I could see from a distance that was my son. So right there, my world was turned upside down. So that began a series of situations in my life, because I was dealing already with divorce from my first wife, and now my son. And here now, he's just ripped out of my life. And I was a very healthy person at that moment. And so after we walked out of the emergency room, and after I identified my son, they took us to the back room where I was kind of losing it. I was feeling really dizzy, and a whole bunch of emotions was just stirring up inside of me. And then as time went on, I lost a job, a very good job, because depression started to set in. I really was never known to be a drinker. Before I came to Christ, I would probably, you know, socializing, I might have a beer or half a beer, just to fit in, I guess, more than anything. But after my son's situation, it drove me to actually drink, and I was drinking some hard liquor because I didn't know how to deal with it. I couldn't sleep. I didn't understand what was happening to me, and I didn't want to admit that I was depressed. And that was my way of dealing with it. I walked away from Christ. I turned my back on the Lord for some time. But yet, in the back of my mind, I knew that He was in control, and that everything was going to be okay. And then going through the process with the court system, with the judicial system, with the sentencing with my son, towards the end, I met my wife now, Marie, and it was a blessing because I was so far from God and I needed help. And the one thing, the least help I wanted was from another woman, because I was like, I don't want to deal with another woman after 25 years of marriage and then divorce. It was really hard for me, and we became friends, and during that friendship, she said, hey, you know, let's go to church. And I'm like, no, I don't want to go to church. And she said, if you want this friendship to continue, you have to come to church with me. I like you, but I want you to come to church with me. And I said, okay, I'll go to church with you. And not understanding that God was using my wife now, to start a process of healing. And I tell you, when I walked into that church that Sunday morning, He was speaking straight to me. And that's when the process started. As far as healing, and with these areas that I was dealing with the bitterness and the unforgiveness, and you know, this tragedy, it really did affect me more than what I thought I was going to be able to handle it. But you know what? I wasn't strong enough, and so. God knew that, and He put this woman in my life and brought me into this church where we started visiting, and healing started there. Finally, a couple of weeks after that, finally there was sentencing. He was the young man that murdered my son was sentenced. And my wife said to me, have you really forgiven this man? And I said, you know what, I thought that I did, but I guess I haven't really forgiven him. And so I had to really work on forgiveness. And that's when I realized that I was dealing with bitterness. And so after I started speaking out, you know, forgiveness over this man, it's when the Lord showed me the bitterness part. And I tell you, you know, anger is a part of it. You get angry over anything, and it's rough because you affect people that you love not knowing that you are affecting them. And so that's the last thing that I wanted, was to, you know, offend or hurt anyone else, especially my family, my children. because I have two more boys. I have two beautiful grandkids that now they're depending on me, and you have to be there for them. You have to be strong for them. And so with time, I thank God that we wind up moving here from Sanford to Bonita Springs close to 6 years ago. And we started coming here to Anchor. And I tell you that when I heard the pastor speak the first time, I fell in love with his words and his method of teaching. And I knew that God brought me here to continue the healing process. And let me tell you that it's a good feeling to be free and be able to smile again, and not smiling because you feel that you need to smile, but smiling because you're happy, smiling because you're free and you have been delivered. God delivered me from drinking, because I became such a heavy drinker. Stuff that I hated the most is what I wanted the most. And so that healing started, and the Lord delivered me from the drinking. He gave me the strength to overcome that. And then, I felt that I was really being delivered from the bitterness part, because I was bitter. I was so bitter. I was, wow. And then I remembered, the Lord reminded me of how I used to say myself, you never know who you're sitting next to and what they're dealing with in life. And you need to express true love. You know, you come to church and you sit next to someone and you just don't know what they're dealing with, what they dealt with that whole week. And sometimes, you know, they're worse than we are, and we act like, you know, there's no healing for us, there's no deliverance for us, there's no freedom. But, you know, sometimes we gotta open up our eyes, our spiritual eyes, and look and be grateful. I am so grateful to be a part of this ministry, because here's where the Lord really healed me and began a new beginning, a new life in Christ. No more bitterness, you know, and no more drinking, and no more sorrow. But God will give you the strength that you need to overcome, the peace to overcome, and the people on your side that love you honestly with a real love, with a Christ-like love. And we need that. The world needs that. So just remember that somebody else is dealing with something worse than we are. And we got to let go of bitterness. We got to let go of anger. And allow the healing to come in. Because I felt several times the Lord really was dealing with me. And it's just like I did not want it. I wanted to be bitter. I wanted to be angry. I didn't want the peace. But I needed it. And I thank God for, you know, my wife that was so patient with me and helped me do so much. You know, that's another key, you know, patience. You know, having the people around you that have the patience and the love to deal with different situations, you know. So, thank God for the healing. Thank God for the pastor and Anchor Church. I'm very grateful. Thank you.
Darkest water and deepest pain, I would wouldn't trade it for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story you'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm sending in confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not forever I am faithful.